because they wouldn't bow and deny their father's name.
My mama said the king stood high upon a balcony so tall. When he looked in, he was shocked by all the things he saw. He thought that he would find them lying dead upon the ground. Instead of three, he counted four while walking all around. Amen. While he's still in the fire and he's walking in the flame, and he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire.
And I said, Mama, wait a minute.
There's one thing that I must know. If three came in and three came out, then where'd that fourth one go? And I never will forget it. Mama danced across the floor. These are the words I heard her say while shouting through the door. She said, he's still in the fire and he's walking in the flame. And he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire. Well, my friends, you may be destined to face life's hottest flames, but I'm glad that I can tell you through the power of his name. Not one flame of fire will touch you. You'll come through it and you'll tell. Yesterday, today, forever, God is still alive and well. Well, he's still in the fire and he's walking in the flame. And he'll be there to help you when you call upon his name. And he can still deliver by his almighty power. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire. While here below, it's good to know he's still in the fire.
Amen.
Amen.
You don't even want to know what he just told me. I mean, I'm praying for you, brother. I hope the power of God. That's what I was expecting. The last thing he said, don't forget, brother, this thing squeaks. Exodus chapter 3. Exodus 3, the year has flown by. I'm always glad to be here. This is my fourth time with your church. I remembered when you were meeting the voodoo factory. And all you had was one guy that was playing the accordion. I thought, man, how did I get in this place? But I knew you were all sincere for sure, of course. And God blessed you because of that. First thing I did this morning, took my phone out and Googled how many miles it was to Fitzwilliam Depot. 68 miles, I think. That's where my mother's body's lying tonight. You know, we always ought to be connecting dots in our life, how God has worked through your life.
Amen.
And that stuff's important to me. I hope it is to you. Mm-hmm. So I tell you that every time I come up here. I love being with your church. And your pastor gave you quite a Sunday school lesson.
Amen.
I mean, I got under conviction, and that's rare. Amen. blah, blah, blah. He talked a lot about discipleship. I have no idea how important that is if you don't know.
Amen.
I mean, I got saved in, how many of you know who Clarence Larkin is, the Bible teacher from the last century, two centuries ago? I was saved in his home church in 1974. You know that. This Thursday will be my, no, pardon, yeah, this Thursday will be my 48th spiritual birthday. And I have a picture in the new book of Clarence Larkin's church, Marcus Hook Baptist Church, in 1874 when he was baptized. I have a picture at the bottom of the page of the same church in 1974 when I was saved and baptized in that church. One century apart to the year. Again, you got to think through stuff, how God's been working with you. And if I stutter, that's my Joe Biden impersonation. But when I got saved, I got muchly saved, like the Blackbridge we put it. But getting saved is one thing. Better is the end of a thing than the beginning.
Right,
of it.
Right.
You can never lose your salvation unless you're a free will Baptist. Amen. Right. But you can lose the joy of your salvation,
sure,
or your effectiveness and your rewards and about a million other things.
Sure. Yeah.
But discipleship is the key.
Yeah.
Because the assistant pastor of that church, where I was saved, Ray Will, you know what? He set me up for discipleship.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't just a Sunday morning only Christian. Morning glories, they call it. I was there Sunday night, and I was there Wednesday night every week. And I had a full-time job. My wife had a full-time job as a nurse at a big Catholic hospital. But every Wednesday night after church was over, the assistant pastor came over to our fancy, swanky apartment in Philadelphia. And my wife always had some pie or cake we had purchased and coffee. And he sat down there and discipled me for a good hour every Wednesday night after church, weekday night, gotta get up in the morning, for, I don't know, 6 months at least.
Amen.
Man, did he help me.
Amen.
I had no clue I was going to get called to preach in October.
Right.
And what God was going to do for me.
Right.
I don't know. He's right about that stuff. You know, the Bible could be true. You never know.
Amen.
All right, you got your Bibles open, Exodus 3.
Mm-hmm.
I hope you all got the new book. I bought extra copies because visitors may come this week on the table. But if you got that book and didn't and is, aren't reading it, you're a dingbat. You're a bigger dingbat than if you didn't get it. Look, I've been here four times. I never say anything that's not worth hearing. How do you know when a lawyer's lying?
Yeah,
his lips are moving.
Right.
How do you know when I'm saying something profound?
Yeah.
Go. What's that, Lord?
Yeah.
They need a new Italian joke right out of the gate. Tony and Vinny are going through the woods late at night, two hitmen in Boston. And it's late at night, and moon's out there, and it's dark with the moonlight still, spooky. And finally, Tony says to Vinny, he says, you know, Vinny, I don't mind admitting to you, as good a friend as you and I is, that I'm kind of scared out here tonight. Vinny says to Tony, he says, you're scared. I got to walk out of here alone in about 10 minutes.
I thought you said a new Italian joke.
Did I tell that last year?
Yeah.
No, I didn't. Did I tell that last year? Raise your hand if I did. Did I tell you what's a good four-letter Italian word for goodbye? Lord, you messed up by now. They already heard that. Did I tell you that one? What's a good four-letter Italian word for goodbye? Ciao? No. Bang. Is that better? All right. So why do you do that? Because this is the 21st century. What's the matter with you?
All right.
You know how messed up everybody's brains are today?
Yeah.
They're beyond bad.
Yeah.
So, got to put the gospel out in comic books. You ever notice Chick Tracks?
Yeah.
I just preached out in Chino, right, 10 minutes from Chino, California. One of the guys that works for Chick was there every night of the meeting.
Mm.
And, hey, you got to put the gospel out in comic book form.
Right.
You ever read Spurgeon sermons? Tell me if you ever read it, hear him telling any jokes.
No. All right.
Not then.
Nope.
That's how the people were. Today, their minds on planet Pluto.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. Amen.
I told you that funny little quip even Spurgeon said. If you know what they said, what should you do when people fall asleep in church? He said, somebody should wake up the preacher.
Right.
I got to keep you awake out there. I was preaching down in Kentucky the other day. And we got talking about Eutychus in Acts, fell out of the window, fell asleep.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, by the way, you know why he fell three stories into the alley? This may be the deepest truth of the week. You know why he fell three stories down and died? Paul had to bring him back to life, right? Because he was more out than he was in.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. Sitting on the windowsill.
That's right.
If he'd have been more in, he'd have just fallen 2 feet.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
I don't preach.
Amen.
This preacher in Kentucky, though, said about Eutychus, he said, you know, you'd have cussed too if you had to listen to a 3-hour sermon. Isn't that funny? Exodus chapter 3, verse 1. Now, Moses, do you want to stand for a seventh inning stretch? You probably do. Those seats are hard, amen? This thing squeaks and not padding is not as good as it should be. The older you get, the less padding it feels like. Exodus chapter 3, verse 1. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Father, I pray that you'll bless us this morning. I always enjoy being here. I mean, I get a double blessing because I feel the closeness to my natural mother. And New Hampshire's always been a strange state to me because of that. But Lord, to have such a good church like this with a committed preacher and his wife and wonderful people, never have had a bad time here. So I get a double blessing. And I want to pay back in the worst way. Would you please speak through me as a conduit as we reveal the Word of God, speak to the hearts of the people, and encourage them and edify them and convict them where needed. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm going to share one of my absolute favorite Bible verses in this message. Here's where this sermon came from 20 years ago. I'm sitting in Michigan in some church during the Y2K crazy stuff. Remember that? And I think I was the next speaker up, and it was a few minutes of dead time, so I was reading in my Bible, and I opened up to Exodus 3, and I got to a verse that jumped off the page and slapped me spiritually right in the head. I was so stunned at what I saw. And that's where the sermon's coming. Now look, I'm sure I said this last year. The biggest mistake that you will ever make as a Baptist is to sit out there. You've heard me say this, when the preacher gives a wild sermon illustration of something happened in his life, or a prayer he got answered, a real big prayer answer, or he shows you something wild in the Bible the Lord hadn't even seen yet, and you sit out there and let the devil talk to you, and he says stuff like this, man, wouldn't that be cool if you were a preacher, and the Lord could show that stuff to you, or answer your prayer, you know what I mean, he'll do that to every one of you if you're dumb enough to listen to him. If you believe like that, go to the Presbyterian Church. Become a Calvinist. Go to the Lutheran Church. Go to any Protestant church, because that's what they believe. They believe in a clergy and a lady. See the bumper stickers, you know? Clergy. There's no clergy and lady in the Baptist Church. You hear that often. It's about time you figure out what you learn what that means. We're all God's children.
That's right.
In a church. You got leadership. Bishops and deacons are there to help you. But God better be speaking to you and answering your, giving you wild answers to
him.
He better be showing you things in that book.
That's right. That's right.
You understand that? That's what the Catholics believe.
Yeah, that's right. Right. Yeah.
48 years ago this week, I was in my last days of Catholicism. Had a Catholic priest marry me on August 17th, 1974. Had Ave Maria sung at my wedding. Say amen right there. 48 years ago that same day, I got my first King James Bible. I told you that story half a dozen times. Sometimes I vary it, and, you know, make it up as I go along. But the gist of it was, my wife gave me a King James Bible in the back seat of a limousine. As we're driving to the Philadelphia airport, spend the night at the Sheraton, fly to Hawaii the next morning. Just left my father waving at me. Just opened up the bar for an extra hour at our wedding reception. And away I go. I hand my wife a little bracelet. Charm bracelet, the backseat of the limo. She hands me a shirt-sized box, gift wrap, opened up, giant print King James Bible. I wasn't even saved yet.
Right.
Took that Bible to Hawaii. I had it with me. What are you doing? Precious memories. I woke up in Kona, Hawaii this morning, 48 years ago. Mm-hmm. My last days as an unsaved man, my last days in the Catholic Church.
Right. Amen.
How about you? You got? Did God ever do anything for you, or you've been dead all this time?
Yeah.
Hey, keep that stuff alive in your heart.
That's right.
So I landed at the airport, at Logan Airport. My mind flashed. I saw Logan. The word flashed back to working for British Airways Cargo, shipping things out of Boston all the time. Logan, I knew all about your airport when I was a heathen. Don't get me started. You get old people talking. That just keep your memories coming out of their ears. Blah, blah, blah. Okay. Let me give you some preliminary observations about this scripture now. Preliminary observations. Did you know that the first five books of the Bible were written by a murderer? Do you know that? Do you know the majority of the Bible is written by three murderers?
Hey, that's wow. Good.
Anybody ever hear of Paul the Apostle?
Right.
He wrote a third of the New Testament himself.
Yep.
How about the sweet psalmist David?
Right.
You know, he was a murderer.
Yep. Yeah.
You understand? Some of you guys have some bad lives. Some of you ladies may have some stuff in your closet. Satan's, you know, rattling those skeletons off.
Yeah, that's
why
right.
Why do you let him do that? Don't you love God enough to believe what he tells you?
Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
Paul told you in 1 Timothy chapter 1, go read it. He said, I was a pattern of God's long suffering. Yeah. You ladies never make a dress?
Yeah.
You men ever use a plumb line when you're building something? Paul said, I'm the plumb line. God chose me to show as a pattern of his long suffering for all those who should believe hereafter, after me.
Yeah,
why did he use me? I didn't just get drunk like Noah and commit adultery and murder one dude like David did. I killed Christians for a living. I punched the clock. That, you got anybody that has a worse track record than Paul?
Right.
Did God ever use? Are you kidding? He was the worst.
Right. Yeah.
You know anybody God used more than Paul after he got him saved?
Right.
He wrote a third of the New Testament, I mentioned.
Yeah.
He was the apostle to the Gentiles. Started Gentile churches all over the world.
Yeah.
What does that mean? He went from the guttermost to the uttermost.
Yeah.
And you don't think God can be pleased to do something with your life
right.
because of what you did before you got saved?
Right. Amen.
Anybody home?
Yep.
Well, why do you keep making excuses for yourself?
Right.
Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain. By the way, five is the number of death. Moses writes five books of the Bible, the first five books, and he was a murderer. By the way, speaking of Paul, if you'll read over in Acts, discipleship principle, the Lord said, separate unto me Barnabas and Saul for the work whereunto I've called them. Barnabas and Saul.
Right.
Barnabas was the trainer and Saul was the trainee.
Yep.
God didn't even give him his Roman name yet to reach the Gentiles. He still's got his Hebrew name, Saul. And he had to do what he was told. But you get to the end of the chapter and it's Paul and Barnabas.
Yeah.
Our day will come. Can you got any patience to wait for the Lord to show you his purpose?
Right.
That's what the preacher's talking about.
Amen.
Let somebody train you and ground you in the faith.
Yep.
Don't be a know-it-all. Yeah. By the way, you might want to read about a guy named Apollos. Yeah. Mighty in the scriptures, but he only knew the baptism
right.
of John.
That's right.
So a man and his wife. Yeah. I don't know what that means. Women aren't supposed to preach, you know, to adult men, you know that, but it says they showed him the word of the Lord more perfectly. And he went away twice as powerful.
Yep.
You know, set out, let somebody show himself.
Yep.
He's good.
Now, let me give you something else here about Moses in verse 1. It's an old outline. Sometimes, you know, some of you have heard these things, some of you have not. He said, how long you've been saved? If there's one thing the devil throws into my ear when I'm preaching forever, it drives me crazy. See, sometimes it's the Lord's voice in my heart, sometimes it's the devil, sometimes it's the voices. How many of you got voices in your head? I got a lot of them in there. I don't know which one is which sometimes.
Yeah.
Try the spirits.
That's right.
Amen.
Whether they be of God.
Yes.
Supper now being ended, Satan putting into the heart of Judas Iscariot.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
Devil can put all kind of. Why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost?
Yeah.
Devil can put all kind of thoughts in your head.
That's right.
But the thing the devil puts in my head more than anything else while I'm preaching, these people know that either. You told it. It's even the Italian joke. He just said, see, you know, you thought you should tell that joke and they already heard it. He's always telling me I've told things to people. I'm in so many churches. You know, you're looking at a spoiled evangelist. I don't know if you understand that. 2020 and 2021, every evangelist I knew was either committing suicide or trying to take a pastorate somewhere.
Mm.
That was a dead work for 2 years.
Mm.
Sam Gipps, my friend, good King James preacher. Most of you know that name.
Mm-hmm.
He put his newsletter out. I get it. I remember in November of 2020. He said I was only in 16 churches in 2020.
Mm.
And we're friends. Good, he's as good a man as there is. Excuse me for breathing. I'm not any better than him or anybody else, but I was in 97 churches that year.
Yeah.
And 103 or 4 in 2021.
Yeah.
How do you explain that? 200 churches plus.
Yeah.
I haven't been out of the pulpit this year on a Sunday. I'm leaving November 27th open. It's a Sunday. It's my 70th birthday. I want a party. Amen. They can't give you a party if I'm out of the air. I'm spoiled.
Right.
And by the way, watch this. Average attendance of my churches and 200 churches those 2 years, average attendance, 50 and below. The great Dr. Grady, do you think those big churches want me?
Right.
They're scared to death. Amen. Paul said they that seem to be somewhat in conference, they have nothing to me.
Yeah.
I don't play a party line. That's what they're scared about.
Right.
The unsaved world calls that being a loose cannon.
Yeah.
Read my books if you think I'm afraid of saying things.
Yeah,
amen.
You're my fat. Now, look, you got a camera here. There's probably only about 140 people here this morning. It's a much smaller church, a larger church than I'm used to. Don't pan the crowd. There's too many people. You won't get them in. Jeff Smith, Hope Sat, New Hampshire. Say amen like that. Maybe you've heard this outline before. I don't know if you've heard this before. But Moses lived to be 120 years old, right? His life was divided into three even 40-year periods. Now, here's a great outline you'll never forget. The first 40 years of Moses' life, he learned the lesson that he was a somebody. Second to Pharaoh in the land. Bow the knee to Moses. The second 40 years of his life, he learned the lesson that he was a nobody. Back there with his father-in-law, Jethro. Every time I read that word, I think of the Beverly Hillbillies. I can't stand it. I just can't stand it. Hey, what are you going to do? We grew up in a nutty age. Amen. But he was funny. But he kept his father's animals. That was like owning herds and animals. That was like your real estate holdings of today. That was echoing. Moses had his father-in-law's animals. He didn't even have his own house for 40 years. He was a nobody. What about the third 40 years, preacher? That's the key to the outline. He spent the third 40 years of his life learning the lesson of what God could do with a man who had learned the first two lessons.
That's good right there.
That might be discipleship again. That might be getting grounded. Duh.
Yeah,
anybody ever heard of John the Baptist? Raise your hand if you ever heard of him. Raise your hand if you don't give a flip. Well, was he somebody? I don't know. Jesus said a man born of women, there was not risen a greater than John.
That's right.
I'm sure he was a good guy then, right? Do you know he spent 30 years being discipled for a three-month ministry? Maybe six, depending on how you look at it. He spent 30 years preparing for 6 months.
Right.
And he's gone.
Yeah.
You know, if you read through my book, you'll have a heart attack for good. It'll explain everything. If you have European ancestors, you are a Japhethite. Never forget that. And God said he was going to enlarge Japheth. Hello? That means bigger is better. That's how you think. How many times have I said this over 4 times out here now? You better get this through your head. You're a Japhethite, but your boss is a Shemite.
Yeah.
The bumper sticker says, I work for a Jewish carpenter from Nazareth.
Yeah.
And God doesn't give a flip about size.
Right.
Yeah.
If it comes, that's great.
Yeah. Amen.
Every man's work shall be tried of what sort it was, it says in 1 Corinthians at the judgment seat. Yeah. Not what size it was, what sort it was.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. God's interested in truth and right. Don't need anything. What does he need you to do anything for him for?
Yeah.
Last chapter of Isaiah says, you build me a temple. That's nice. I use the earth for a footstool.
Yep.
Yeah. I'm sure it's a nice temple. But to this man will I love.
Yeah, amen.
Even to him that, you know the rest of him. That's my Joe Biden impersonation. You know the thing. He trembles at my word.
Amen.
I'll be okay by Tuesday. Just come back tonight, come back tomorrow, but Tuesday I'll be okay. Excuse me for breathing. I drove 16 hours from Texas through the night. Thursday night I left, 10 o'clock. Got into Tennessee sometime about, I don't know, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Look, what hotel did you sleep in? Are you nuts? I don't give money to those. You want the room with elected people? I sleep in my truck for 50 minutes in a truck stop parking lot and go in Louisiana and keep going. You can't get to church here? I'm going to really take some baby aspirins about that. Got home and crashed and burned at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. What'd you do next? I took my wife out for anniversary dinner, of course. I missed her anniversary the previous Wednesday. You think she's going to let me off the hook for it? That ain't going to happen. I have to act like I was awake and cut the snake. Then got home and crashed about 8, 9 o'clock at night. Got up at, I don't know, some ungodly hour, 6 o'clock in the morning, something, to fly here to be with you. I'm going to be 70. You keep up with the same jokes every time I'm up here to do the same things. That's what the devil says. You keep doing that to people. Get out of here. How about you? You know what the New Testament equivalent is of that outline? It was 3 40-year periods. Apostle Paul, Philippians. I can do all things. Confidence from the first 40 years, what you learned. I worked for the largest airline in the world in a marketing position. Transferred out of Park Avenue office, New York City. I mean, God gave me plenty to start my confidence building in. But then he had to break it down. When I got saved and called to preach, I worked out when I was going to a steel mill. I was so dumb, I was on the bottom of the janitor's, with, was grade 2 paycheck. I was a hooker at 4, hooking up tanks with a crane. I couldn't do anything technical, I was a dummy. 5 years working in a steel mill. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me.
Amen.
After you get beat down and humbled a little bit and knuckle under, let God rub your nose in the dirt a little while, he's doing that to strengthen you.
Yeah.
Then he turns you loose.
Yeah.
You need both.
Yeah.
Verse 2, and the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. You need to be learning things. Why should I beat this typo? So you can learn the word of God. Every time you see that phrase, the angel of the Lord, most of you by now should know that's an Old Testament appearance of the Lord. Jesus himself. An angel is one thing. The angel of the Lord is always Jesus. And listen, he's not only in the Old Testament, he's in the New Testament. There's the shepherds getting the announcement about baby Jesus being laid in the manger, and the one talking to him is Jesus.
Yeah.
You're going down there, I'm 2 places at once. Amen.
Amen.
He's the one who takes Peter out of the prison in Acts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You should know that, okay? Where do you get all that from? If you're taking notes mentally or on paper always, if you're interested, Genesis 16, verses 7 through 13, Hagar out there, cast out from set by Sarah. Remember, the angel of the Lord meets her.
Yeah.
I've seen the Lord face to face, she says, you know. You start putting that together. I'm just giving you preliminary observations. Now, that bush that we're looking at there, it's mentioned over and over and over again. That's the first major picture in the Bible of the nation of Israel. That's why, you know, most of you have my book on Israel. I have that burning bush on the front cover, right, with Moses' sandals subliminally put in there. That's a picture of Israel. Why is that a picture of Israel? Turn over to Malachi real quick. Last book of the Old Testament. We call it the book of Malachi. Amen, if you're Italian. Malachi chapter 3. Amen. All right? Picture of Israel. Malachi chapter 3. Look at verse number 6. Malachi 3:6, for I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, ye sons of whom?
Jacob.
That's Israel. Are not what?
Consumed.
That bush burns, see? It keeps burning, but it never burns out. That's what God did with that miraculous nation. He's kept them preserved.
That's right.
All these years, since the 2,000 years after they were, you know, ejected out of their homeland for rejecting their Messiah, God kept them alive. Kept them scattered, but he kept them together. And here's another one. Look at Deuteronomy 32 real quick. Deuteronomy 32. Deuteronomy 32, verse 9. 32, verse 9. For the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance, right? Now, where did the Lord find the Jews? Look at verse 10. He found Jacob, he found him, verse 10, in where? A desert land, and in a waste, hollowing wilderness. He led him about, he instructed him, he kept him as the apple of his eye. You know, you You're not far from Kennebunkport, Maine here. I know you know that, right? I was preaching up in Dover, Foxcroft a year ago, and I went up to Kennebunkport, and I saw President Bush's mansion up there. You know, most of you have this book. Here's a picture most of you should be familiar with. There's a picture of Bush 41 walking through his bedroom. Very few people have ever seen this photograph. Just try to Google it and see if you can find it. It was in a small newspaper up in Maine, and a Massachusetts, a Boston disc jockey or a newscaster gave me the reference where I could find that photograph. It's an AP picture. What's he doing walking through his bedroom? Because the house was torn to pieces. Because he's over in Spain trying to burn them Jews up there in a peace conference, forcing them to give their land to Mr. Arafat. Here's the New York Times front page headline. Mideast foes list demands and trade angry charges across conference table. There's Menachem Begin and there's the Palestinian leader there. They're fighting over there in Madrid, Spain. Bush 41 is overseeing the meeting. And he's pressuring those Jews to give up their land in order to get some peace promises. Mr. Arafat, put those hand grenades down. Front page of the New York Times. Right next to that picture, there's a picture of the storm that tore Bush's house up.
Yeah.
It was so bizarre, they made a movie about it after a book was written about it. The perfect storm, never saw anything like it.
Yeah.
You don't want to mess with those Jews. They're the apple of God's eye.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Tell me your neighbor. Hey.
Amen.
You want to see something crazier than that? I voted for Mr. Trump. And if he runs again, I'll vote for him again. But listen, he may never even get there. He may be in jail.
Yeah. Yeah.
Somebody's pushing for civil war in this country. Can you
yeah.
see it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
Because then that would be crushed by martial law, goodbye Constitution. Not that it's worth anything now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right.
You better read this before yeah. you're in jail. You'll get insight.
Yeah, that's good. Amen.
Hey, it's got 82 photographs. What else can I do for you? Look at this. Hey, your books are too big. Your books are too big, Brother Green. What are you going to do with this one? 82 photographs in it. Here's your first photograph. There's Bush and Netanyahu raising their hands in victory, announcing their peace proposal plan for two-state solution in Israel. Give the Arabs a capital in East Jerusalem. Give them half the country. It was the bad half. The Arabs didn't even show up. But look, there's Netanyahu and Bush. I mean, and Trump, yay! Do you know both of these men were out of office in 16 months?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you know this guy was impeached twice? Trump's not a globalist like the Clintons and the Bushes. The head of Israel, he loves Israel. Anybody ever hear of a guy named Uzzah? God killed the man for making a mistake. Smote him for his error. God can kill you for making a mistake, much less for sinning.
Right. Yeah.
He loved Israel, Uzzah. The ark was going to fall on the ground. He didn't want to have that happen. He's trying to keep that piece of furniture from hit the ground. God cut him in half. He didn't kill him. He made a breach in him. A lightning bolt. Cut him in half. The man after God's own heart. You ever heard of David? When he saw that, this is what he did. Look.
That's right.
Holy mackerel. What a just he had no clue.
No, right.
You don't know anything about God.
Yeah,
I don't hardly know anything.
Yeah, amen.
Though I'm saved.
Yep.
Yeah.
You don't want to mess with that Jew.
That's right.
Oh, and by the way, in case anybody's interested, this was November, this was January the 28th, 2020, that picture's taken. You know what happened 8 days earlier? That peace treaty was already signed. It just got announced here in the Rose Garden. You know what happened 8 days before that? I don't know. Nothing significant, just the first outbreak of COVID in the United States, that's all. In Seattle Hospital. Wuhan, China, Chinese American, came back.
Yeah.
By the way, check the timing. That was Martin Luther King Day, Monday, January 20th. That's when COVID hit this country.
Yeah.
Why should you say that? I don't know. What's the matter? You can't handle reality. That's what it was.
Right.
Are you saying anything? I'm not saying anything. I'm just telling you what happened. Now you know why they don't have me in the big conferences.
Yeah, you
I'm going to take a baby aspirin about it. 2 days later, after the COVID broke out, before this announcement about two-state solution, they stuck a microphone in Bush's face. Where was he at? Davos, Switzerland, at the headquarters of where the Antichrist is going to run the world from, that World Economic Forum you're reading more and more about, the Great Reset,
yep.
Klaus Schwab and all these, Prince Charles, all these pervert globalists. Trump's sitting there because every leader has to be there now.
Right.
They stuck a microphone in Trump's face. What about that disease that just hit the fan 2 days ago? And Trump meant well. I said I'd vote for him again. He's a leader. He's trying to be positive. He says all that was just one man. Everything's under control. We've got this. I got the exact quote in this book. We got it. It's going to be okay. You don't want to mess with the apple of God's eye. I don't care who you are. Who's who? The devil.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
You know, Dr. Ruckman wrote a book. Look, every church in America has got plants up on the platform. What's the matter with you people? That's all I got. Anyway, if you had a plan how to put my fingers in, and all the comments about holy Quran, holy Virgin Mary, the Holy Father in Rome, you know, holy, anybody remember Amos and Andy, holy mackerel Andy, and Batman and Robin, holy mackerel, Robin, Batman, remember all that stuff? But every religion's got a million things that are holy. Dr. Ruckman put a book out years ago called Israel, Deadly Piece of Dirt.
Right.
And he pointed out that the first thing God ever calls holy in the scriptures, dirt.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
That's right.
Remove thy shoes from off thy feet. Mm-hmm. For the place whereon thou art standing is holy ground.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
You don't want to mess with that little piece of dirt the size of New Jersey.
That's right.
God will mess with you.
Yep. That's right.
Now, you need some oil for this thing. Now, having said all of that, those are the preliminary observations I just wanted to give you. What is the main lesson of the message this morning? Very important. It's extremely practical. It's about your spiritual life. Let me set it up for you. All of the activity that we just read in these opening verses, one back there to Exodus if you're not there still, this is what jumped out and hit me sitting in Westland, Michigan, Prayer Baptist Church. Grandson of J. Frank Norris was the pastor of that church, Larry Bartlett. He's kind of retired now. And he's got dementia problems and so on, but good man. I was sitting there 20 years ago, and the verse I'm going to show you jumped up and slapped me. Like, you ought to have verses due to you in your Bible.
Yeah, man.
Now, let me set it up. Ready? All of the activity that we've read in these 5-6 verses in Exodus 3 took place on Mount Horeb in the Sinai. The word Horeb means glowing heat, thus the very presence of God. You got a burning bush. By the way, Bush 41 and 43 should have been more worried about the burning bush and not Bandar Bush.
Yeah.
Saudi Arabia representative pushed the bushes around all the time because of the oil situation.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's good.
Got a picture in my book here of Bandar Bush sitting in there and with the president, with Bush 43 sitting on his couch. There's 43. There's Bandar Bush, the billionaire Saudi ambassador, sitting on Bush's couch, on the arm of the couch, talking down to him. There's 43 holding the Saudi prince's hand, walking through an airport. Those guys are under, they're so pushed around.
Yeah.
Biden's not pushed around because he doesn't know where he is to be pushed around. That's the truth.
Amen.
Hebrews 12, don't turn to it. Hebrews 12, 29, our God is a consuming fire. Okay, drum roll, time's arrived now. Got everything set. If you don't act impressed when I show this to you, I will be depressed. You know what that means, don't you, children? I can always tack on another hour. All you've got to do is act interested and blown away. How many planning on looking blown away? All right, are you ready, neighbor? Here we go. Now here's your assignment, ready? Horeb's the key. Horeb's where all this took place. That's where the burning bush was, right? I'm only going to ask you one question, ready? Look where Horeb was or is located. That's the key to everything I want to get across to you this morning. Hello, get ready. One verse, verse 1. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, colon, here it comes, and he led the flock to where? The back side of the desert, and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb.
Yeah.
What's that got to do with anything?
Yep.
It's okay. I'm here to point it out to you. The will of God is the speaker today to help you.
Amen.
Now you saw it. Let me tell you what. COVID. Listen, man, I'm telling you, neighbor, I know you got a tissue box up here. Don't you have a tissue box
right here?
Huh? What's it doing over there by the cameraman?
I had to clean the lens.
Cleans the lens. Here. Now look at here. Look. Before COVID, a preacher could do this all day and all night while he's preaching. Look.
Yeah, right.
I'm telling you, neighbor, anytime I do that, I feel the love all of a sudden.
Yeah.
Everybody's looking. Look.
Yeah.
Everything's okay.
Yeah.
Why'd you say COVID? You can't? Because I throw it back at you folks. I'm not going to take all the heat off. Anybody coughs in there? COVID. Now, by the way, if any of you get a visitor here this week, will you use some common sense and kind of tell them about me before they come in? Okay, ready? Where was Mount Horeb? It was on the back side of the desert. You know what that means? All the way across the desert. Greatest lesson you'll learn this week, maybe? Probably say that tomorrow night's sermon and the next sermon. Oh, here's where Moses is. And there's the desert. See the piano? That's where Mount Horeb is. That's where God is. Here's where Moses is. Hello, anybody want to get close to God tonight?
Amen.
Didn't say Mount Horeb was at the entrance of the desert. It didn't say it was at the midway point of the desert. It didn't say it was at the end of the desert. It said it was on the back side of the desert.
Right. Yep.
You all want fellowship with the Lord? Sure. But you want to skip the desert.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's good.
That's right.
That's not how it works. Did you hear the little girl sing a song?
Yep.
Three went in, four they saw, and three came out.
Right. That's right.
Duh.
That's right.
I preached that in my seven pillars of wisdom sermon.
Yep.
He stays in there. He doesn't come out of there. You want to see him, that's where you go to see him.
Right. Amen.
You want to cross, you want to see him? Right. You have to cross a desert to see him.
Yeah.
Do I know everything? Heavens no. I've saved almost a half a century. I know something. If you want to see a burning bush, you have to cross a burning desert.
Right. Amen.
If this was a black church, I'd say, can I get a witness?
Amen.
By the way, Brother Grady's a racist. That's what everybody says because I teach you the Bible. Go look at all the pictures in there of me with all my black preacher friends from the past. There's so many of them, you can't even fit them into a picture.
Yep. Amen.
They thought I walked on water in my heyday, back in the 70s.
Yep.
How could you make up a story like that? I tell you about that guy, that black dude, give me the key to his house.
Yep.
There he is right there. He just bought a new house. I said, am I getting a new key? He says, you're going to get a new key, brother. Let me give you an historical illustration of what I'm trying to say. This is as good as it gets. Like I said, come back by Tuesday. I'll be back on top. Let me give you a historical illustration of what I'm trying to show you. 159 years ago, on July the 3rd, at approximately 12 to 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, the third and final day of the Battle of Gettysburg was about to take place. 12,500 Confederate soldiers were waiting in the woods for 270 of their cannons to finish a two-hour barrage of the Union lines up at the top of the ridge. 2 p.m., our time, Pickett's charge began. These 12,000 troops had to cross all the way across a three-quarter of a mile field, open field, to get to the Union line. They had to make it all the way across. The battle lasted less than 30 minutes. Those 12,500 Confederate soldiers were cut to ribbons.
Yep.
50% casualties in 30 minutes. Years later, when asked why his charge at Gettysburg had failed, General Pickett reportedly replied, quote, "I've always thought the Yankees had something to do with it," end of quote. Lieutenant Colonel Waller Tazewell Patton had his jaw blown off by an artillery fragment. He died July the 21st. He was the great uncle of General Patton. What's that got to do with you and I? The supernatural power with God that we want, represented in Mount Horeb, the glowing heat of God's presence, ready, is located at the other end of the spiritual wastelands of this world, where God just chooses to put you and I. Coming short only counts in horseshoes and hand grenades. You go to Gettysburg, I've been there before, some of you, anybody ever been to Gettysburg? You go there, they'll show you what they call the high water mark of the Confederacy. Looking up at that Union line, off to the right, there's a jag in the wall there. That's the closest the Union Army, the Confederate Army, got to the north. They broke through that little section of the wall. It's the only place they breached. And within just a few minutes, the Unions had it overrun with reinforcements and drove the Confederates back. And there's a sign there today, the high water mark of the Confederacy. They didn't make it. Coming close only counts at horseshoes and hand grenades. And that's how it is with us.
Yeah.
You're never going to know God like God wants you to know Him.
Right.
Unless you're willing to cross that
right.
desert.
That's right.
And by the way, you don't really start on that cross until you've had some discipleship.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's. You ever wonder why Christians bomb out?
Yep.
They never got grounded.
That's right.
You ever read the parable of the sower and the seed?
Yep.
Then cometh persecution
yep.
because of the word, and the way they fizzle out. They dry up.
Yes.
Read that.
Yeah.
Now, having said all that, here's the main part of the message to make it make sense to you. I want to show how it applies to you. Something they teach in Bible college. Give them the truth, instruction, then you give them application. Now, let me tell you how this applies to you, and then invitation. Now, what are you going to do about it? Instruction, application, invitation. Information, application, invitation. Very simple outline when you're teaching people about teaching Sunday school, doing anything. I gave you all that information. Now, what's it got to do with you? You have to cross through the same terrain that Moses crossed through if you want to meet that God over there. Now, here's the things you've got to deal with. In no particular order, okay? This is what Moses went through. Why don't you just sit there now, because you love the church, and most of you appreciate me, and you know God's trying to help you this week, right?
Amen.
You don't think I have, after 48 years of preaching, I can't come up with six sermons? This is what God put on my heart in the airplane.
Amen.
So, God's got it for you right now. So start taking a little inventory in your heart. Which one of these things has got you hung up crossing?
Right.
Think about it.
Right.
God wants you to deal with it. He wants you to deal with it today.
Right.
To help you. Look, I preached in North Carolina last week. Every time I go over there, Salisbury, North Carolina. Every time I go over there, they say, "Dr. Grady's here to help us." And when I leave, they say, "He really helped us." Now I'm here to help you.
Amen.
Here you go. Number one, how about barren, rugged landscape. What do you think? You think that was like going through Hawaii, crossing that desert? Anybody ever been in a desert? That's a rough place. How many ever been in a real desert before? That's fun, isn't it? You know, you got a scripture that says endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. That caused most of you to go back to Starbucks. Amen, right there.
Yeah.
That's it. First thing you run into, you go home.
Yeah.
Read the first chapter of my new book. It's called The Last Latte. I was going to call it the Last Days. That's exactly how I plan. You know, Perilous Times is the title of the book. Chapter 1, Last Days. And the Holy Spirit said to me, as sure as I'm talking to you, he said, forget that. That's dull. He said, besides, I got a better title for you. What's that, Lord? The Last Latte. I said, Lord, what's that all about? He said, basically, in my little heart, the way you ought to be talking to you.
Right.
He said, if you think these nutty Americans think they're going to be having $50, $25 coffees to pick from several more months or years into the future, they're crazy.
Yeah.
We're going to start learning how our grandparents grew up.
Yeah.
And if you can't sense something's going on, you're nuts.
Oh, yeah.
The day I was born, Harry Truman was having Thanksgiving dinner in the White House. I was born on Thanksgiving Day, 1952. I've seen 15 presidents and one resident. No, 13 presidents and one resident come through in my little time on Earth. Some of you ladies are older than me. How old are you, Carol? Hey, don't you told me she was 70?
She's 29 and holding.
Yeah.
Anybody remember Jack Benny?
Yeah.
He was almost 39.
Yeah.
Hey, this folks older than me, though. Haven't you seen some crazy things in the last 2.5 years, 2 years?
Yeah.
It's not even over yet. It's just starting. The last latte. You better drink your lattes now. I'd store them up if I like them, because they're not going to be available very much longer. Can't even get baby formula right now.
Yeah.
Hey, the big blowout.
Yeah.
Can I tell you how dumb I am? Would you, if you promise not to lose confidence in me, I'll tell you how dumb I am. How many of you ever heard the term idiot savant? An idiot savant, that's somebody that can do one thing real well, but can't do anything else.
Right.
Now, I can write books, but I'm about as dumb as a box of rocks about most technical things. I was coming home from a 10-hour drive one night about 2 o'clock in the morning. I don't know where I was coming from, but I was coming back to Tennessee. I live in the Smoky Mountain region, East Tennessee. I was on Highway Interstate 40. I wasn't more than 25 minutes from my house. I was so happy. I was so tired. Then, pow! Had a blowout. 2 o'clock in the morning. Driving a Dodge Ram van, I think. Oh, was I bummed out. I was so bummed out. I don't know. You think I had a flashlight? I don't have that stuff. I don't have anything that makes sense. I'm on Interstate 40, 2 o'clock in the morning, cussing the day out of my birth. Said, were you really saying bad words? Well, if you wrote the words down, I'd put my signature on it. Let's put it that way. I was fussing with the Lord. Anyway, I got out of there. Somehow I got the jack up. I jacked out and jacked the thing up and changed the tire. It was a miracle. And put the tire back down with the new tire down. And I was so mad. I don't know if I should even tell you this. You're either going to lose confidence in me or think I'm crazy or I'm not spiritual. I know none of you have ever had a bad day. He's looking at the floor right now. None of you have ever messed up, yes? I told you last time here, Brother Smith and I are messed up just like you're messed up, which is not as messed up. We'd be out of a job if we were as messed up as you are. Well, let me show you what I did. Picked that tire up. It was all tore up. Couldn't patch it up. I got so mad. You know, I said, forget this. There was an embankment like a half a mile down. It was like a valley, some kind of a stick. I took that stinking tire, you blackety blank tire, and threw it down the whole mountain. I had to forget you. I got back in the van. He that sits in the heaven shall laugh. I thought I heard some chuckle. I'm going down the road. About 2 minutes later, the Holy Ghost said, you know, you threw the rim down there with the tire.
Who's laughing?
Listen, any of you still have any confidence in me? Come on, I was having a bad day. Devils were fighting me. That was my favorite blowout.
Yeah.
You know how long it took me to find a rim to fit that thing? Number two, you have to pass through dry, drought-like conditions. Turn to Psalm 63 real quick. Psalm 63. Preacher came to pick me up yesterday at the airport with his father. What a disaster that was. Took him about an hour, you know, 2 minutes from the airport. He couldn't get to me. There was 50,000 traffic jams. I'm at Logan Airport. I left the shaded curve, you know, where everybody's crowded. I crossed, you know, at the airport, I crossed over to the island, little island over here where you can get to me easier than jamming in with all the crazy people who are in there. But there's no shade here. I'm standing there, you know, and 45 minutes, an hour, an hour and 10 minutes, I'm dying over here, dehydrated. I didn't have any water. What does it say in Psalm 63:1? Oh God, thou art my God, early will I seek thee. Look, my soul thirsteth for thee, my flesh longeth for thee. Where? In a dry and thirsty land where no water is. That's that desert you're crossing right now. So I'm thirsty. I can't make it. Keep going. You know what's over there? That's where horror is. And besides, don't tell me what a big wimp you are. Your Savior said on the cross, I thirst.
That's right.
Yes.
Yep.
Number three, you have to deal with wildly fluctuating temperatures. Isn't that how it is in the desert? In the daytime, it's hot as the devil. At nighttime, it's as cold as the Arctic. Yeah. Isn't that how the Lord took those Jews through the wilderness for 40 years? Pillar of cloud at night, fire at night, pillar of cloud in the daytime. Pillar of cloud shielding them from the hot sun. Nighttime, it turned into fire to keep them warm. But sometimes God lets you cross that desert without letting you have that comfort. He's trying to show you what you're made out of. You know what? Your flesh is so sorry. It is so sorry. You are so convinced as to how important you are. That's your lost nature. You got to learn some of this stuff. Hey, does anybody ever lose their temper? Anybody ever get mad? If anybody's ever gotten mad once in your life, raise your hand. Want to learn a deep truth? Learn a deep truth? You know why you get mad anytime? Because you're convinced your rights were just violated. That's why you're mad. Think it through so you learn something good. If you're not real deep thinking, think that through. Why did you get mad if you didn't feel your rights got violated? What rights do you have? I lost track. The right to go to hell? You got any rights? This is how many rights you have in God's presence. Zero. Once you learn that, you won't get mad so often. Or you'll find out now why you have a hot temper. You're overly inflated with your self-importance.
Yeah, amen. That's good.
Paul said, I die daily. How could you have any rights if you're a dead person?
Yep. That's
good. See, these are great spiritual truths. Most saved people in Laodicea never even hear them. Too busy wanting to know if the church they're looking at has a Starbucks deal there in the church. What kind of programs you got for my kids? Number four, shifting sands, along with sand storms that come out of nowhere. Hey, you ever been that way in your passage? Are you crossing right now? You go to bed one night with a certain landscape, the next morning you wake up, and everything's different again. That's how it is crossing a desert. That's part of your life's purpose to get through this thing.
Good preaching.
It's just meant for you. Look, God's giving you a chance for you to show Him how much you love Him. Lord, I don't count. This hurts. You made me to hurt. That's why it's a trial. I don't enjoy it, but I love you more than I love myself. I'm not going to complain to you because you put me through this. Thank you for letting me have a chance to show you that I love you. That's how you're supposed to be doing it. How come you don't do it? Maybe you never got grounded. And by the way, want to hear something funny? Some of you might be saved a lot more than just 2 years. Maybe you saved 10 years, but you never got discipled in the 10 years. You just happened to be here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe you have a spiritual wife or a spiritual husband that keeps you dragging around, but you don't know anything either.
Yeah, you're good.
Preacher, would you be offended if somebody that was saved longer than 2 years thought, I think I might, like a concentrated class?
Yeah, it's good.
Maybe you ought to start offering them a menu, though.
Yeah.
Where they got to eat, they don't have to take what you just feed them. Went to Jersey Mike's yesterday and a Philly cheesesteak. Changed my life. That's it. Number five, you got mirages. Hello. Anybody ever heard of those things? You see something, it's not there?
Yep.
Hallucinations. Hey, number six, how about isolation? That's tough. You don't cross with anybody else. You cross alone. Mm-hmm. Just like you have to cross the great Psalm 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no. Hey, you can't take anybody with you down the road. See, most Christians are so stinking insecure. They have to have friends. And they always worry what people think about them. That's why they run in herds. They can't stand by themselves. Number seven, and last, turn to Mark 1. This is the last one. Mark 1, this is the toughest one of all, probably. I'm trying to tell you, this is what you're going to have to encounter. This is what you are should be encountering right now as I'm talking to you. I mean, yesterday in the afternoon, something hit you. You hit a rugged piece of landscape.
Yeah.
Or you know, you're dying of thirst.
Yeah.
This week.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what the Bible's for. It's meant to be a practical help.
Yep.
Now look at Mark 1. Here's the Lord got baptized, verse 11, and there came a voice from heaven saying, Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And immediately the Spirit driveth him into the wilderness. Now I don't know, that's meant to show you that he didn't want to go in there on his own. He's representing us. Mm-hmm. He's at all points tempted like we are. But the Spirit drives him into the wilderness. They're all working together, the Trinity. Now look at verse 13. This is a picture of you. And he was there in the wilderness. I think he was there by himself, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Hello. Mm-hmm. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan, and was with the wild beasts. And the angels ministered unto him. We didn't talk about that in Matthew and John's account of him in the desert. He was with the wild beasts and the devil.
Yeah.
How's it going?
Yeah.
Have you run into the devil since you've been crossing that desert?
Sure.
He's not going to mess with you. He's going to send his little imps after you. He don't care about me or you.
Yeah.
He's got Ephesians 6. He's got a hierarchy of evil spirits. Are they working on you? If they're not working on you, something's wrong with you.
Yeah.
How many times have you heard me give that quote? Some old black preacher said, I heard him say one time, if the devil's kicking you in the pants, at least you know you're out in front. And he's standing on one leg. If you have no opposition, something wrong with you.
Amen.
The Bible says the devil's always a great Bible truth is the devil's always looking for a place to spit. It's an old Southern expression. And America's become the greatest spittoon the devil's ever eaten.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you're in this country trying to do what's right for the Lord, get the gospel spread, he's going to mess with you.
Yeah.
Paul said, how often would I have come unto thee, even I, Paul, time and again, but Satan hindered us. Satan hindered us, Paul said. I'm no charismatic. But that verse tells you that the devil can stop you from going from point A to point B.
Amen.
If God permits it.
Yep.
And God will.
Yep.
That's why Paul was shipwrecked. William Tyndale gave you the first New Testament English language. See, if he didn't get shipwrecked, lost all his manuscripts, all his translation work for years, down in a shipwreck, God let that happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Acts 27, look at the cover of that new book, that shipwreck. One third of the New Testament was on that boat. Luke and Paul, they weren't done with their writing. Nine books of the Bible were yet to be written when the devil sunk that ship. The devil knows what he's doing. He ain't messing with me. Well, you must not be messing with him then. Is that hard to understand? What's the deal? Being tough? Again, you know, Paul told Timothy, the young preacher, be thou an example unto the believers. Is that what it told you? You know what that means? The preachers that come through here better be practicing what they're preaching to you.
Right.
Now look at this. I'm not going to point this out all week. I'm 69 stinking years old. I'll be 70 in November. Hello? Well, how do
you do that? I push because I love God. That's why I push. Yeah. I got the privilege to do it. Been like this all my whole Christian life. My whole life. Ask my wife. She said, my wife will give a testimony. You know her, Linda. She'd say, I've been riding on his coattails, flapping in the breeze for 48 years, she'd say. We got saved. I got saved 48 years ago last Wednesday, or the 17th of this month. No, the 25th of this month, coming up. Make a note. Thursday. Shoot, man, I got saved in the morning service. I'm coming down the steps of the church. The preacher says, see you tonight, Brother Grady. I said, okay, man, cool. I said to my wife, they Baptist got mass twice on Sunday? I didn't know. I was back in a New York Minute Sunday night. My Southern Baptist wife was home watching television. Say amen.
Amen.
Sunday night, I found out the man's the spiritual leader of the home, so we were both back Wednesday.
There you go.
She had to catch up a little bit to me. She didn't want me to be that saved. Especially when I surrendered to preach 2 months later. She got a little scared. But see, she didn't come out of Catholicism.
Right.
She grew up in that
yeah.
Baptist background, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
Again, I'm not lifting myself up. That you know better.
Right.
At least you're saying, that guy practices what he's preaching.
Amen.
Maybe I should try it.
Amen.
Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.
Amen.
Blessed is the man that trusteth in him. Okay, I'm winding down now, past third base, two-thirds of the way to home plate. Let me just tell you, how do I get across, preacher? I want to make it, but I'm in one of those seven places. I'm in two or three of them, and I'm bogged down. Sandstorm just hit me. Can't even see where I go home. I'm here for the meeting, thank God, but I got bills on the table. I have no clue what to do with them. Why are you listening to this sermon right now? God's got it planned for you to help you. How do I make it? Well, it's very simple. Let me give you three things. Number one, we have a reliable map. Does anybody know that? Look.
Yeah.
That'll help you get across.
Yeah,
Psalm 119:105, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Psalm 119:130, the entrance of thy words giveth light. Let me tell you something else you have. You have a reliable guide. Isn't that good to have a good guide?
Yeah.
Romans 8:14. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Mm-hmm. Let me give you real quick number three. I love it. We have also not only a reliable map and a reliable guide, we have a reliable prayer partner. Somebody's pulling for you to get you through. Hebrews 4:14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed from the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. See? Then you read over there in Mark 1, he's in that desert where you've been, and he was there 40 days without having a thing to eat. That's not as bad as what you're going through right now, Peter. Let me close. Look, there's two times when the congregation can really shout it out inside, right? Here's the first time, when the preacher's had his jacket off for the whole sermon, and when he does this. You know what I mean, don't you?
Yeah.
I say, when's the other time, preacher? Look. When he closes the Bible. Normally, every Bible closes it like a cacophony. It burns the preacher's ears out. The Bibles are so noisy. Preacher, look, this is good. Look, nobody, I can't believe it. Let me close with this. Monday through Thursday, I was at Shady Acres Baptist Church in Houston, Texas. I posted something on my Facebook page called The Running of the Bulls, the Baptist Running of the Bulls. Every year at their camp meeting, every service that starts, as soon as it starts, all the kids jump out of their seats and run. And they run around the auditorium. Now, I am so going somewhere here. You can't see it necessarily from where you are. And they just run like crazy. And they crash and burn, fall out on the curves, get run over. That's just wild. Isn't that funny? Just running up in the aisles, all around the auditorium like that. They can do that. They can do that for 20 minutes. You start seeing at the end, they're all burned out at the end. You know, they start falling out, collapsing, pain coming down.
Isn't that crazy? Run like crazy. I call it the Baptist running with the bulls. Now that little kid right there is a little autistic boy. Now what's that got to do with anything? I am so going somewhere with this. A year ago in June, not this past June, but the June before that, there's two little children running the laps here. There's two other children, two other sisters of these four little kids that are here. And their dad has a church there up in New York State. And I preached up there, and they took me out to a lake to have a service. Crossed on a boat. It's a tiny little island. And we had preaching on the island. It was about 10 of us there. I preached on Jesus asleep in a boat. Their third oldest child took a violin out and played a special. Here it is. She's playing Amazing Grace on this little island. Her name is Olivia. I am so going somewhere with this. I think she's about 12. Remember, I'm going somewhere with this. I'm all done with this. Sir, with this. I'm filming it with my phone. Year ago, June. There's her daddy with the blue shirt on right there. That's the dad. Amen. You hear that? What's that got to do with anything? This past June, that was a year ago, June, two Junes ago. This past June, I was at their church preaching, and we didn't go out to the island. We had a wonderful service. The pastor's name is Albert Adamkowski. His wife's name is Hannah. And he's got these four little kids. The oldest one is adopted. Her name is Maddie. Olivia was the girl playing the violin. They had just purchased a 90-acre farm. Pigs everywhere, chickens. He has 1,000 apple orchard trees on the property. He's always trying to raise money for missions. Breeds deer in Texas somewhere, you know, trying to get the right kind of combination of genes. He's always doing something, and he gives away money like crazy to God's work. And he's pastoring a church. It isn't very big. He's a roofer. He probably has about 25 people in his church. Loves me to death. Now listen, neighbor. I spent 3 nights in their house this past June. 3 weeks or so, 4 weeks after I was there, they had a couple visiting them from Texas. The wife's from Houston, from this church. Can't mean running the bulls. They had a couple come up to visit with them, stay at their house. They went out to that lake to have another service, crossed with the little boat, Albert Adamkowski and his wife Hannah, their four kids and this couple in the little boat, got to the little island. Had a service there. The kids got playing out in the water. They have a, what do you call that? When it's like a sandbar. You could walk out there maybe 500 yards, a couple of hundred yards at least, you know, 2 feet of water. Looks like you're walking on the water. You know, all the kids play out there. But they got to a spot where it dropped off and nobody really understood. And at least one or two of the kids fell into the deeper water out of nowhere. I think the little one got out, but that girl playing the violin, all of a sudden she was in bad shape. Going under. Her daddy jumped on that boat and shot out to her. Dove in. Another couple that wasn't even connected to them. They just happened to see everything. The man came out. The daddy, Alp, the preacher, grabbed that girl when she was going down for the third time. Just in time, yanked her up. Look. Spun her around backwards to the stranger. Held on to her. And they turned around. Daddy was gone. I mean, he was gone. Two funerals. One up in New York. One down in Houston just a couple weeks ago. I just saw that little lady. I called her on the phone the day after it happened. I really miss that brother. Not nearly as much as Hannah does.
four children, two of them, a little challenge, mongoloid type situation with a little guy, hair lip type thing, and the other girl thinks something's totally not right. Sweet children, though. Two older girls, sweet as they could be. And she said the girl that was drowning, the violin, first night she woke up screaming in the middle of the night. She's so convinced that it was her fault her daddy's gone. Look, neighbor, I was a little kid, my mother used to say, I used to feel bad because I had no shoes, though I met a person that had no feet. Remember those kind of old proverbs? You don't hear them today. I don't care what you're going through. You know, there's always somebody that's got it tougher. Every time those little kids ran around the loop, the two smallest ones were running. You know, she's too sophisticated now. You know, you get to that age, you're not going to jump in with the little ones. But the two little ones kept coming around, and I kept, you always put your hand out there and they're smacking your hands, you know. The bigger boys, you mess them up when they come by so they can't catch your hand. They all, the littlest kids, you know, the littlest girl, I mean, that high, come by, try to smack your hand. It's the cutest thing. And I'm thinking of pedophiles. They're after all those little kind of sweet things. But every time them little kids, her little kids came by, I had a dollar bill in my hand. Boy, they were stopping real, they slow down and make sure they didn't miss that dollar. I can't bring their daddy back. How about you, neighbor? Can you see yourself in this field, in this wilderness? Let's bow our heads for prayer. Let's stand to our feet.